History is full of examples of people, personalities, names, figures who have been documented as having achieved a benefit for the people, whether it was some kind of victory, whether it was some sort of celebrity status, to the extent where generations after them have been taught about them, have learnt about them. In the Islamic history, we have various figures benefited the Muslim Ummah or the community to such an extent whereby they then became famous. Their stories have then been relayed to generations who came after them. But with the vast majority of those people, of those figures that we know in our Islamic history, were born and raised in the Muslim world and were born and raised as Muslims. But the person we're going to speak about is unique. He wasn't a scholar. He wasn't somebody who was very knowledgeable about Islam. And more importantly, he wasn't somebody who was born and raised in the Muslim world. The person, inshallah, that we're going to speak about is infamously known as Malcolm X. And you may think, why speak about a person like this? But inshallah, if we look to his life and just use this as an example, we should be able to, inshallah, draw some comparisons with our life, with our situation, and some of the issues that we are facing currently in our time as a Muslim minority living here in the West. To begin with, Malcolm X was born as Malcolm Little in 1925 in Omaha in America. He was born in a time which was very shortly after what is called the Atlantic slave trade. During the 16th and the 19th centuries, the Europeans and the Americans, they went into Africa, primarily West Africa, and enslaved them in America and in Europe to work in their coffee, tobacco, sugar, cotton plantations, their gold and silver mines, their rice fields, construction industry, timber, so on and so forth. So these Africans, they came into America, they were treated as commodities, people who could be bought and sold. Their life was worth nothing. And it isn't until the 19th century when this was officially on paper outlawed. But in that society, the people still held very discriminatory, racist views towards black African Americans. Malcolm Little, he's born in an era, in a time where this racism and this discrimination, this injustice against black people is rife. He's born in a time where there is color segregation in all aspects, in all spheres of life. If you go to go and drink water from a public water fountain, there'll be certain ones for black people, there'll be others for white people. If you were to go to the toilets, public toilets, there'll be separate ones for blacks, there'll be separate ones for whites. The public opinion at that time was that blacks are inferior. They're foreigners and they are outsiders. They've come here, but they don't have the same value and the same worth as a white American does. And you found that there were also groups that existed at that time, which still continue to exist today, like the KKK, the Ku Klux Klan, who were very racist white supremacists. And very often, they would take black people and they would publicly lynch them, tie them up, burn them, crucify them, execute them, kill them, without suffering any consequences, and they'll get away with it. From a very young age, his own house is firebombed by these white supremacists. From a very young age, his father is killed. His body is placed on a trolley track. The trolleys go over it, decapitate him. Later on, he goes on to say that it was actually the KKK who were responsible for killing his father. They put it down to what? An accident at work. Nobody was brought to justice for that. This was the order of the day at that time. A few years later, whilst he's growing up, his mother is diagnosed as being mentally ill. Him and his siblings are put into foster care. Now, Malcolm, he had an ability that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instilled within him, and this was the gift of the gab. He was very articulate. He was very charismatic, but he had a keen interest on education and study. From a young age, he wanted to become a lawyer, but he was told by his teachers at that time that you're a black person, you'll never be able to be a lawyer. Black people only do hard labor, manual work. So he drops out of education. When he drops out of his education, what does he do? He hangs about on the streets. Similar to what we see, unfortunately, nowadays, where we find that a lot of the youth, when they have no direction, when they have no vision, when they have no future prospects, when they have no actual meaning or purpose to their life, they just do whatever they think is best. And if you associate with people who are involved in this haram, who are disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you yourself will also become like them. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said in a famous hadith, "Ar-rajulu ala deen al-khalili," that verily a man is upon the deen of his friend. The deen of your friend, meaning the way of life of your friend. If you associate and you accompany and you hang about and befriend people who do haram, people who are completely disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have no fear of Allah, who don't care about halal and haram, then you too will end up doing those same things. And likewise, if you associate with people who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who remind you about halal and haram, who remind you to pray and to fast, and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you too inshallah will be upon that path. فَلْيَنْدُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِلْ. So therefore, be very careful as to who you choose as your friends. The only companionship and the only friendship that will last in this dunya and in the akhirah and will be forever is the one that is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Malcolm, he gets involved in this company on the streets, doing all of this hustling, prostitution, drugs, theft, crime, all of this sort of stuff. Eventually he gets caught. Now at that time, remember, he's living in a time where there's a huge amount of injustice towards black people. A huge amount of discrimination and racism. So if you were a black person at that time and you were accused of something, you had very little or no chance of getting justice. So he gets sentenced to 10 years in prison. Now all of a sudden he's away from all of his friends and all of this circle of people that he was associating with. Off the streets, he's in isolation. He has time to think, he has time to reflect, he has time to put his life into perspective. And in prison, what does he do? He comes across a different circle of friends, a different circle of companions, a cult by the name of Nation of Islam. For those who don't know, the Nation of Islam is a cult, is a group that abuse the name of Islam. Claim to be Muslims, they are not Muslims. Their beliefs are in clear contradiction with that of Islam. They are a racist group. Their beliefs, their ideology was only for black people. And they would push this idea that the white person is the devil. White people are shayateen, or the devils, and they need to be fought. So this is what he became involved in, and he adopted these ideas and these concepts of the Nation of Islam. Now in doing so, what did he do? He felt that me and my people suffer a problem in this time in America. We need to rise, we need to make a stand, we need to do something about it. So the first thing he does, he picks up a book to try to read. He realizes that he can't even read one page of the book. He was almost illiterate. He says later on that he tries to write a letter to this man called Elijah Muhammad. He tries to write him a letter. He said, and on the streets, and he says, if I was talking, I was very articulate, I could convince somebody. But he said, I tried to put those same words into writing and I was unable to do so. He said, I wrote it over 20 times, that same letter, but I couldn't do it. So what did he do? He decided, I need to study. I need to learn. I need to educate myself. So the first thing he picks up the dictionary and he begins to study and learn and memorize the dictionary. Once he's able to do that, he's then able to read books, he's then able to study, and he spends pretty much the rest of his time absorbed in books. He reads about literature, philosophy, all sorts of things, educating himself, not just reading for the sake of it, but learning, memorizing. This was his belief at the time, that the white people, they use language against us and they defeat us by this. So in order for us to fight back against them, we have to also study and we have to know what they know as good as they know. At that time, when he adopts these views, this is in prison, this is where he changes his name actually from Malcolm Little to Malcolm X. And the reason why he gives himself an X is because he says this name, Little, the surname, is the name that was given to me by my slave masters. He says, my ancestry is different. You see, they'd call the people John and Little and Jack and whatever. These aren't African names, obviously. So he gave himself the name X because he didn't know his ancestry. So he was known as Malcolm X. 6 years in prison he spends, then he's released. Upon his release, now he's a fully fledged member of the Nation of Islam. Tirelessly campaigns the justice of black people, using his eloquence, his caliber, to try to recruit people, to try to wake people up in the community. The black people at that time are sitting back idle, allowing all of this injustice, this dhulam, to befall them, without raising any finger, without even raising a word against it. So he goes out there from state to state, city to city, campaigning, trying to wake people up, trying to get them to realize that you need to make a stand. You need to do something to change your own situation. And as a result, he begins to recruit huge numbers of people. And in fact, he was also promoting at that time, not just for people to make a stand, campaign, and defend against all of this injustice, but he was saying to people that, look, when those white supremacists come, when those Ku Klux Klan people come, when they take and they do their public lynchings and they beat people and torture people and they kill people, take arms and defend yourself. You have a right to defense. You have a right to defend yourself. So don't just use your tongue. Physically fight them off to show them that, look, we are not going to tolerate this anymore. And until and unless you don't do this, our situation is going to continue like this and it will continue to get worse. So he's there campaigning, he's giving speeches, he's giving lectures. He's invited to universities and colleges. He's out there on the streets speaking to people. He becomes very famous. He becomes well renowned. He's doing interviews in the media and the news. He sets up his own newspaper magazine. He begins to circulate it, all in order to try to wake the black community up he becomes very famous, but one of the consequences of that is that he also then creates a lot of enemies from government. In fact, the FBI opened a file against him to investigate him, his doings and what have you, all the way down to the layperson, to those white supremacists, to those racists, to the general population. But he continued for many years campaigning like this. He traveled to the Middle East, he traveled to Africa. He wanted to gather support, he met heads of states. He in fact wanted to take the mistreatment of the African American people all the way to the UN and try the Americans for this. This was his aim, this was his objective. So at that first travel that he made throughout the Middle East and Africa in 1959, he intended upon doing Umrah. Now remember, all this time, he's going under the banner of the Nation of Islam, a racist group that is nothing to, has nothing to do with Islam. But he wanted to go to Umrah, to Mecca and to do Umrah. But he wasn't able to do so the first time because he fell ill, so he went back. At that time, he became a little bit disillusioned with the Nation of Islam because he began to see certain hypocrisies. So he began to become a little bit distant from them and speak out a little bit against them. It isn't until a few years later in 64 when he's then able to travel again to the Middle East. He travels to Egypt, Lebanon, Liberia, Senegal, Nigeria, Ghana, and then he's actually able to go to Mecca and to do the Umrah. When he goes to Umrah, it opens up his eyes. He sees all this time that he's been campaigning that the white man is the devil. The white people are the enemy. And that black people are in fact superior. But when he goes to Umrah and he's there in Mecca, he sees people from all different parts of the world. Black, white, all different races, all different cultures. Everyone come together, united for the sake of La ilaha illallah, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He saw the way that Islam unified all different people and absolutely obliterated the whole idea of racism. And this opened up his heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sparked hidayah into his heart. And it is then where he actually embraces true Islam, where he actually embraces Islam and he denounces the Nation of Islam. He changes his name to Al-Hajj Malik al-Shabazz. Now he's a true Muslim. And what does he believe? He believes that Islam is the solution to the problem of racism in America. So he continues to go from state to state, meeting heads of states, trying to campaign and lobby to the UN the mistreatment of the blacks in America. And he says that Islam is the solution to white Americans, to turn them away from this racism. He goes to Paris, he delivers a speech. He comes to the UK, he comes to the Oxford University to do a debate here also. But then when he goes back to America, you see now the very people that he befriended, the very people that he supported and he campaigned for and worked alongside, they turned and they switched against him to the point where his life was in danger and his life was threatened. They evicted him from his home and repossessed. But yeah, he carried on, continuing speaking against them and calling people to the Islam that he understood at that time. His house was firebombed. People were in fact sent to assassinate him, to kill him. He even states that, you know, they tried to put a bomb onto my car so that as soon as I put the key in and started, that's it. And they ask him at that time, you know, are you not fearful of this? Do you not fear that any moment in time you could be killed by these people? And he says his famous words, and you can see his interview that it's available widely. He said, I'm a dead man already. I'm a dead man walking. He said, they put a hit out on me. They intent upon killing me and finishing me off, silencing my voice. He said, it's only a matter of time. But yet he continued. He continued struggling. He continued speaking. He continued to campaign despite knowing all of this. His family was in danger, his children are in danger. He armed himself with a rifle in case they come into his home. And he said, I have my right to defend against anybody who's gonna attack. And it isn't until 1965, when he's in New York in an auditorium, where he's about to deliver a speech, whereby he's then shot at point blank and he's assassinated and he's killed. Who did it? There's a little bit of controversy about it. The popular narrative is that it was the Nation of Islam who actually killed him in the air. Allahu alam, there's theories to say that it was actually the state or people higher up who wanted him dead because he became too famous and too influential. And he began to know too much and he exposed too much. But Allahu alam, that's the end of Malik al-Shabazz. But it isn't, in fact, because his legacy lives on. And I'm sure we all know and we must have seen, you know, there's videos and documentaries made about him, there's books being written about him. They teach him, you know, in black history. They teach about him and about his struggles. He left a legacy. He was somebody who came from such a poor and primitive and simple background, who was an absolute nobody. He wasn't educated. He wasn't somebody who held degrees. He didn't have much knowledge about Islam even. But he came from nothing and he became somebody. Yet he did what most Muslims fail to do. What even, unfortunately, a lot of scholars, they fail to do. Which is to make a stand, to speak the truth, to speak out against oppression, to speak out against injustice, to help those who are being oppressed, to help those who are being mistreated. This is what he did. This jahiliyyah that existed in his time, in his society, this jahiliyyah of racism, he fought against it and he strived against it. Fought for justice. He showed care and concern for his people, for his community, for others. He didn't just sit back and think, okay, you know, the problem is going to solve itself. He didn't just sit back and think, so long as I'm okay, I don't mind. Let things continue and be as they are. Maybe, you know, time will heal them. No, he was somebody who wanted to make a difference. He's somebody who felt the problem and wanted to do something about it. And in fact, this is exactly what Islam teaches us. This is exactly what our deen teaches us. Not to be passive, not to be idle, not to just sit back and allow all of these things around you to happen. All of this evil, all of this oppression, all of this dhulam, all of this injustice to occur, and for us to sit back and not even do anything about it. In fact, Islam teaches us the exact opposite of that. Man ra'a minkum munkaran falyughayyiru biyadihi. The Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, if you see evil, if you see falsehood, change it with your hands. Do something about it. Falyughayyiru biyadihi. Change it with your hands. Do something to make a difference. فَإِن لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ. And if you can't physically do anything, فَبِلِسَانِهِ. Then at least use your tongue. Speak out against it. Say something. Do something. If you see dhulam being committed, if you see injustice, speak out against it. Do something about it. Try to make a change. Try to make a difference. Don't just sit back and think that everything's going to be okay. The Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us, look, if you see Muslims being oppressed, support them. Do something about it. Unsur akhaka daliman aw madlum. Support your Muslim brother if he's an oppressor or he's being oppressed. And subhanallah, there is no shortage in our time, in our day, now. There is no shortage of Muslims being oppressed. Wherever we look, we see Muslims being oppressed. Injustice is being committed towards us. The Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, support your Muslim brothers. Don't allow this to just happen and ignore it and think that it doesn't affect you. The Sahaba, they said, Ya Rasulullah, we can understand how we can support, it makes sense to us. We support those who are being oppressed. But what about the oppressors? Because the hadith says, Unsur akhaka dhalim o madlum. Support the dhalim and the ones who are madlum, the ones who are being oppressed. He said, by standing alongside him and preventing him from doing his oppression, preventing him from committing the dhulam. So you see, there's no excuse either way. You have to do something about it. This is why Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah, he says that the one who remains silent in the face of dhulam, in the face of injustice and oppression, he is like the speechless, the dumb shaitan. Because you can have somebody, like I mentioned before, that you can have friends, and they may invite you and take you down a path which is full of haram and disobedience and all of these evils. But those people who do that, and they say that, and they invite you towards all of that, you see, they are outspoken shayateen. Outspoken shaitan, because they're clearly inviting you to do haram and to be disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what about the ones who see you going down that path? Going down that path that will lead you to Jahannam. Knowing where you're going, knowing what you're doing is wrong, but then they remain silent and they just watch you doing it. You see, this is the dumb shaitan. This is the shaitan that is speechless. Because the one who doesn't speak the haq, the truth, when there's a need for it to be spoken, this is like the one who, the shaitan who is the shaitan al-akhras. The shaitan who is dumb. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْمُرُ بِالْأَدْلِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to work for justice, to establish justice upon this dunya, the justice of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُونُوا قَوَّامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ. O you who believe, stand out firmly for justice. Stand firmly for justice as a witness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ. Even if it means that it goes against your own self, even if it goes against your own parents, even if it goes against your own kindred, your relatives, your friends, those who are close to you, speak out and stand for justice. speak out for the issues that are of concern, those pressing issues of our time, in the way that Malik al-Shabazz he did in his time, and in the way in which, in fact, the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, he lived in a time, in a community, in a society that was also very racist, that committed the dhulm and oppression. They were very tribalistic. If you belong to certain tribes, you would be mistreated, you would be seen as being inferior. If you were black and you were from Habasha, Ethiopia, you would be considered as being inferior, as being worthless. They committed dhulm against each other. They committed dhulm against their women. They committed dhulm against their daughters when they buried them alive. They committed dhulm in the way that they treated each other. And more importantly so, they committed dhulm against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by committing shirk and worshipping idols and associating bonds. Inna shirka la dhulmun adheem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the greatest dhulm, the greatest form of oppression is shirk. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was there. Amongst all of this, did he remain silent? Did the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ignore all of those injustices, all of that oppression that was being committed? No, rather, he struggled against it. He struggled to change the situation of the people at that time and in order to establish justice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him, Ya ayyuhal mudathir, kum fa'andir. O you who is the one who is wrapped up, go out and proclaim. Go out and warn those people. Warn them that they are committing grave, grave oppression and injustice that will lead them to the fire of Jahannam. Call them to Islam. فَاسْدَعْ بِمَا تُؤْمَرْ وَعَارِضْ عَنِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Go out and proclaim openly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go out and speak. Do something about it. Change the situation that you are in.